So let me share my screen. So we'll talk about visualization. So the goal of visualization is to get the data out of the computer and into the human brain. People are definitely visually oriented, and visualizations for representing data are really, really important. So that's why we have this separate presentation on that topic. So what are the types of visualization? Well, you have mathematical visualizations. We won't talk about that. Here's an example of fractals. Fractal, yeah, probably you have all seen that. If not, you can Google it on YouTube or something, but they allow you to infinitely zoom in that presentation. Then you have traditional information visualization, domain-specific visualization, for example, in medical imaging. And then finally, which is more the topic of this week, scientific visualization. Usually we deal with coordinate data. So usually we have some space, can be two-dimensional or n-dimensional, where each instance is represented by a point in that space. And we want to visualize that type of data. So what are the different modes? So the first type of visualization are statistical graphics or plots. So its main purpose is to visualize scientific results and make complex data more accessible, understandable, and usable. And so you can think of a line plot, a histogram, scatter plot, or a box plot. These are the traditional statistical graphics you would include, for instance, in an academic publication or a master thesis or something. And then the second type of visualization is an infographic. So these are really visualization made for presenting some idea, and its main purpose is communication. And so it's really about presentation and really present information quickly and clearly. And typically they're designed for a broad user base. And so they don't make a lot of assumptions about the reader's knowledge than, for instance, statistical graphics. And infographics are often used, for example, in newspapers or on websites, things like that. And then finally, you have interactive visualizations. So there the purpose is to explore the data and find patterns. So usually you have some options to filter or select a part of the data and then click on that subset, and then you can explore and browse the data and find something interesting. So it supports user input, and that's also an important type of visualization. So an example of an infographic, I used some examples from my own work. So this is a visualization from my PhD thesis. And actually you see two types of visualization, and on the left you see that there are a lot of combination. It's a complex graph. So actually it's combinations of words. And you can see that you have single words and then you have all different pairs of words, and that's a lot of combinations. And on the right, you can see that it's less cluttered. So I included this in my introduction, and the idea was just to present that you have less combination using my methods to convey that. So I assumed less knowledge about the reader, and just focus on presenting a key idea. So this visualization was created using a radio tree, and it's available in the D3ES library. We'll look at tools later on, But it's a JavaScript-based library for creating all types of visualizations. And then another example of an infographic is a part of a poster. So typically, if you go to a conference or something, you create a presentation and also a poster that you can present. So that's also type of infographic. So this poster was created in PowerPoint from Microsoft. You can also use something like Adobe Photoshop or some other tool. And the subfigures, like here the line plots on the bottom, they were created using Python and Matplotlib. Okay, and then here's an example of an interactive visualization. This is based on a tool I created 2 years ago. And you can see that there are some things you can select. So here we show a time series. And actually, this is a tool for anomaly detection. And so the red bars indicate segments of the time series which are considered to be anomalous. And you have different options here to filter the data to show, for instance, the anomaly score of some methods. You can, if you have multiple time series if you have a multivariate time series, you can select different Y columns and so on. So here, and also you can filter on the start and end date. So here, the main purpose is really to explore the data and the user can select or drill down on the data. So this tool was created with a web service. So the web service basically contains all the data in JSON formats. And by selecting these options, by various options of inputs, the web server returns a part of the data. And then the visualization is done with JavaScript in the browser, because if you want to have some kind of interaction, that means you need some software running on the browser, and most applications, almost all applications, then use JavaScript to provide some interaction. And then an example of a statistical graphic and plot. So here again, a plot from one of my, it's from my thesis, sorry. So here the purpose is really to visualize scientific results. So often you see tables with results, but then it's much harder to interpret that data by a human. So with a line plot, this is a line plot created in Matplotlib. You immediately see different methods here. Each method has its own color. And then you have the y-axis doesn't matter and the x-axis, but you have this dependent variable. So that's the y-axis, that's our target, that's what you want. And then you have the x-axis with the independent variable. And I used a line plot, but I also made sure to highlight the different methods each the same color. I also hidden some lines to make the plot more clean, like top and the right top line, the right line or the grids are not shown. I also included little markers like a circle, triangle and a square. And I included these markers because, some people are colorblind. And also with academic papers, they're often printed in black and white. And if you then print it, then you can still distinguish each method. So that's an example. Here's another example from my PhD thesis. So this is a bar plot, also created in a Matplotlib. And again, I've used color to highlight different methods. And I used spacing. And so here we have two data sets on the x-axis. And for each data set, we have three different methods. And I report the runtime in seconds for executing each method. And so humans are really good at distinguishing between data points using lengths. So the y-axis depicts the length, so the total runtime of each method, and you can immediately compare the different methods for each data set. And I also included a baseline. So these three colored methods, they all have a base step, which is mining item sets. And to make that clear and to see what is the additional effort of mining, for instance, the blue one is mining sequential patterns, you can see that's the additional time needed compared to the baseline. So that's also something to take into account if you report scientific results, is to have some kind of baseline measurement. So you make it explicit to your end users or to your readers what you want to compare with. And finally, a last visualization. Here I use a critical difference diagram. So a critical difference diagram is based on a statistical test. And so that's why I wanted to show it to you. What does this visualization mean? Well, basically, these are 13 different classification methods. And so they try to predict some kind of label. And I've run each of these 13 methods on 85 data sets. And then for each data set, I look at the rank. So the method with the highest accuracy then has rank 1. And the method with the worst accuracy has rank 14. It's 40 methods, sorry. And then I compute the averages over all different data sets. But important is here, you have these solid bars, and these are clicks. And you see basically three major clicks. So one on the left, one in the middle, and one on the right. And so that means that the first five, five methods, they're in the first click, meaning there's a difference in the rank, like Hivecode on average is ranked in the 4.2 position, so it's ranked higher than a Rocket, so it works a little bit better, but it's not statistically significant, so that's based on a Wilkinson rank test. And so that's also of interest in these plots, to include some kind of error bars or statistical significance. And that's also created in Python. So takeaway points for scientific and other publications. Visualizations are essential for communicating main ideas. For communicating main ideas, you can use infographics. And you can use plots to display experimental results. So you have to be aware that people have little time, and often what you're writing, also your thesis and things like that, is complex. So often people only look at the abstract, the section titles, and also the visualization to quickly check your publication. And often people do that and then decide if they are going to read it in more depth or not. So they're really important. Infographics are also important, so they really help the reader to understand a key idea. So good infographic represents a key idea as simple as possible. For statistical graphics, you always should use 2D graphics. And also take into account that people print in black and white or are colorblind. Include statistical significance if possible, for instance, using a box plot or a critical difference diagram, and include some baseline methods whenever possible. And so there are many tools and libraries. In Python, you have matplotlib. In JavaScript, you have D3ES. And for infographics, you can use something like PowerPoint or Adobe Photoshop. Okay, that was the kind of the introduction. Now let's talk about 2D graphics. So 2D graphics, there are actually two types of 2D graphics. So you have vector graphics and raster graphics. And with vector graphics, you actually draw data with a coordinate system. So that means you have these primitive elements, such as a line or a circle, and actually the vector graphics format contains the position of and the coordinates of all those lines. Of course, with vector graphics, it's a representation. It has to be rendered or displayed to the screen, and the screen is always based on pixels. So when you render vector graphics, the system decides which pixels to illuminate, and that's also called rasterization. And then finally, you can also store graphics in pixels directly, so in raster graphics. So there you have a two-dimensional matrix with for each pixel usually a value for the three colors. Like that, and then finally, when you rasterize a graphic, you get aliasing effects. So that's shown here. And so in the top, you have a line without with aliasing. So this it's like this type of stair. Of course, if you zoom out, it's less obvious. And below, you have the anti-aliased version, which will look much more pretty. If you much more crisp if you don't zoom in. So that's in essence what 2D graphics are. And when you're creating a plot, you're basically using vector graphics. So what you do is you have a coordinate system. In mathematics, often it's at the left bottom, but if you're programming within a graphical library, often the coordinate system is at the top left. With the coordinate of with y being zero, we're actually in the top left corner. And so in many libraries that you use, for instance in Python, first you have to create something like a canvas or a figure in Matplotlib, and on that figure you can start drawing. Another properties of these vector graphics is that you have a hierarchical coordinate system, and that's actually something used to help you. So, for instance, you have world coordinates. That these are the absolute coordinates of the resulting raster image. The coordinates of your raster, but then you also have local coordinates. And for instance, I can make a graphic which contains four charts, and then the charts will be divided. So you have one on the top left, one on the top right, and so on. And then the local coordinates are the coordinates local to one individual chart. So usually, you program in local coordinates and then transform that sub chart and display it on the final coordinates. And so it can be a chart or any object of basic shapes such as line, rectangles, circles, and so on. If you have composed a vector graphic in this way, then the system takes care of doing the necessary coordinate transformations, such as moving part of the vectors or scaling and rotating each object to have this final image with everything on it. This is another example, an example of a scene graph, which I was explaining previously. So here you have this car and these windmills and mountains, and if you look at each individual object, you can see it's composed of basic lines and circles. And if you create this kind of graph you can create this kind of graph by programming, and then in the final image, everything is composed using coordinate and using simple rotation scaling. And movement, the coordinates are transformed to world coordinates, and everything is yeah, visualized relative, in the correct position. And so that these type, this is a simple drawing, but you can, if you want to create data visualization, you use the same principle. So you first program simple objects like a single line or a single plot of one line consisting of the of different segments, and then you have these simple mathematics for computing the transformations such as moving and scaling that part of the graph to the final position. Scalable vector graphics are a format, and they support that. So it's written using XML. You can just edit it in the text editor. And also an advantage of vector graphics, because in essence store just coordinates and line, is they are completely scalable. So that means you can zoom in without a loss of quality. And also they offer better quality when printed. So that's also important. If you're going to print data in a raster format, usually it's not that crisp. The quality is a little bit worse. And you can also program scalable vector graphics using JavaScript. And so that also means that you can create interactive visualizations using JavaScript and SVG. So here's an example. So this is just a circle. So you have some HTML code. So it starts and ends with HTML. Then you have the body of the HTML. These are two tags which are in every HTML document. And then you have your SVG canvas, if you want, with a width and height of 100 pixels. And then within that SVG element, you have a circle and you give the coordinates, the radius. It has a green color, a green fill color. It has a yellow fill color, a green outline, and the width of the outline is 4. This is another example. I copy-pasted some codes that I made for this interactive visualization. You see in the lower left. So actually, this is the code in JavaScript to draw to draw the line. So actually, in my case, I have different time series. So a time series is just a vector of continuous values. And in the bottom part of my code, I loop over each time series. I assign each time series a unique color. And then I plot those values using the function time series plots, which I have defined before. So what are the steps here? Well, you have this array of values, and then you go over each point in your array, and you basically create a small a small segment. So you just connect the values of y at position k with the value of position y at k plus 1. And so then you have these small line segments. And if you do that for all values, then you create the illusion of this continuous line that's shown here. So in this case, I use the canvas. So the canvas is the vector graphic image you can draw upon in each HTML page. And you have some operation like stroke style, which sets the style of the color of the line. And then with begin path, you move to each coordinate, and then you create a line to the next coordinate. So in that way, you connect piecewise every segment and have this final visualization. Then 3D graphics. So 3D graphics are modeled using triangle meshes, and you see an example here above. So the basic principle has remained the same for the past decades. So I think the rabbit on the upper left would be a game released 20 years ago, and now the graphics looks great, but it's just because you have because you have more triangles and a better approximation of an actual surface. And so each mesh or each object is created by these individual triangles. And then you have a camera model. It's called the pinhole camera. It works like your eye. So starting from this point, you project your three-dimensional space to a two-dimensional surface, which is your screen. So all data points get projected, and then you have a perspective. So things that are far away after the projection will look smaller. So that's in essence how 3D graphics work. And it's important because our brain, we perceive the world, which is three-dimensional, so that 3D graphics capture that. And so you have occlusion. Occlusion is the property that an object that is before another object hides that. So you can see that in the visualization. So that's an important property of 3D scenes. And here you also see it. It's a 2D graphic, but we still have that perception. We still see that the moon is after the pink bar, which is after the blue star. Then you have perspective. So large things are in the front. Objects in the back look smaller. And then you have lightning. And so with lightning, you have this diffuse lightning. And so here, again, three examples of the same rabbit. The first visualization is just the triangles, so after perspective, but you see the outline of the rabbits, but without lightning being rendered, you cannot actually see that it's a rabbit. And then in the second, in the middle visualization, you see the diffuse lighting, so light reflects in all direction on the surface of each triangle. Yeah, so here, like below the neck and the main body, you can see it's a little bit darker, and that's because light is less reflected in all directions there. And so that gives the appearance of an actual object in three-dimensional space. And then finally, you have the specular lightning. So that's shown on the right. And there you really have bright, white, more kinds of illumination for surfaces. So that's typically also more obvious for metal objects with a smooth surface, and that also is a part of the rendering. And then some optical illusions. So here you have some examples where you can see that our visual system is actually quite, and it can make mistakes. So you have the Escher drawing, and then you see that it's a confusing images. So you have these connected connected stairs, if you want, but it doesn't. It's confusing. You also have the Penrose stairs in Inception, or this triangle sculpture in Australia. So that shows that there's a difference between viewing something and perception, especially for 3D representations. That's something we'll talk a little bit more about. So perception, so how do we percept the graphics we see? There are a lot of factors that influence our interpretation or perception. So it's not only about the visualization, it's also what's in your head. So your cultural values, your needs, your belief, your past experience, your expectation, other personal factors. These are really important when you talk about perception. There's also something called perceptual constancy. So that's the tendency to see familiar objects as having the standard shape, size, color, or location, regardless of changes in the perspective, distance, or lighting. And that's important if you're creating graphics, so that you're aware of the facts that people see objects that are familiar as having the same shape and size and location. So if you design a graphic, you should be aware of that. And also on the other side, things like perspective, distance and lighting can be a little bit confusing, because in essence, we are used to, we have our perception of the three-dimensional world. And so we'll see some examples where we actually misinterpret the data based on that human bias. And so here's a first example. So we always assume that the lightning comes from above, like the sun comes from above. So our brain perceives the first image as a bump and the second one as a dent. So that's one bias in our perception. And these are also some figures, like the first figure with the IBM logo. And we can clearly see the letters despite of the spacing between. And so we have this perception of closing up different shapes. Second is another example where we also clearly see two triangles, like the white one, even if it's not clearly drawn. So we kind of still see it clearly. So that's also important in our perception. And then the last law, the law of proximity, where you see here really these different clusters of points together. So if you design a graphic, you can really use proximity or location to separate different groups, and we will see them as different entities. Here another example. It's funny. So you have the circle, and actually they have exactly the same size. But as humans, we perceive, we kind of regard the context. So because in the left, you have these big circles around it, we see it relative to these big circles. And that means a little bit smaller. But if you would measure it, they are actually exactly the same size. So that's important, especially in the context where you have some scientific data, and you really want to make your visualization correct. And then you don't want to, I don't know, represent it in this way that people get confused because of our perception. And then color is also important. So here I'm not colorblind, so I can see the number 74 in the circle, but especially males, about 10% of males have some color vision deficiency. So that's important when you design a plot, a graphic, that you display some additional information, except from different colors or different hues. And so I showed the example before. Here I used markers. Yeah, so with the markers, even if you're colorblind, you can still distinguish each line and see the underlying methods that is associated with that line. This is another example of deceiving humans using perspective. So in the first graph on the left, you can ask which line is shorter, A or B. So you would think that that A is longer, but actually they're exactly the same size. So that's a really simple example of how our brains fools us, because it thinks it's shown in perspective. And on the right, you have another diagram. Again, you have A and B, and B looks much longer because of that context, the context of the parallelogram, but actually they're again exactly the same size. So you really have to be careful with perspective and also with only using angle to discriminate different parts in your data visualization. So based on these previous points, you should also avoid 3D graphics. So our perception of size is based on our perception of how far the object is away from us, and that can mislead you about the actual size of an object. So in Excel, you have three-dimensional bar charts and I don't know what, but you should not use them in a scientific publication. So how late is it? I propose maybe we take a small break and then I'll continue with the next slides since we're about halfway. Is that okay? Any more questions up to now? Any questions? No? Okay. Then a 5-minute break.